So I have to admit something to you after that intro. I'm actually not a natural born storyteller, which I know is pretty shocking because I'm actually standing in front of you today to talk about storytelling. But my friends and family, I'm sure, would all tell you just how long-winded I can be. And I'd like to think that it's because I want to ensure that every last detail is captured and conveyed. I don't know that they would really agree with that, but anyway. Some of you may also face similar challenges when it comes to storytelling, but fear not, I bring good news. I think that anyone can learn to be a good storyteller and, in fact, tell stories for good. So here's the thing. Like many of you here, my background is in international health and development. I've spent the bulk of my career at the intersection of communications, policy, and advocacy to help set and drive impact against really big public health agendas. And also, like you, I chase impact. And it's that chase for impact that has led me to my current role, where I lead the global public health and corporate impact work at GCI Health. We're a global healthcare communications and public affairs agency. And I joined this role after several years and many positions in the NGO and multilateral space, most recently as a health advisor in the UN Secretary General's office. Throughout my career, I've learned a lot about what it takes to really tell and craft a good story. I've also seen the power of storytelling, both good and bad. You know, I think that I've always been drawn to the power of a good story to shift culture. And I think it's probably one of the reasons my career has taken the path that it has. Over the years, I've had the privilege to work on a variety of really exciting public health campaigns, like YouthAIDS, United Against Malaria. I even supported a corporate partnership with the Miss Universe organization that integrated a reigning queen into a campaign to redefine masculinity within the context of HIV and AIDS in Latin America. And it's definitely another story for another day. My work has taken me, like many of you, around the world. I've been welcomed into communities, into homes, and into sacred spaces. I've seen and I felt just how a good story can unite communities and shape global discourse. And I've also witnessed and learned from poor practices when it comes to how we are capturing and conveying these sorts of stories. So with that, let me tell you a story. I know, just bear with me. I promise I've gotten better at storytelling. When I was 24, I moved to Argentina to complete my master's practicum. And while I was there, I was working with the Ministry of Health in local HIV and AIDS clinic, where I focused on community needs and psychosocial care. And it's there that I did, to this day, I promise, some of the work that I remain most proud of. Working with eight individuals at a local, working with eight individuals who were receiving care. So the slides will come. When I was in Argentina, right, I was working with the local Ministry of Health in an HIV and AIDS clinic. Here it is. And it was there that I did this work that I am just so proud of. So we working with eight individuals who were receiving care at the clinic. Thank you, Vanna White. Thank you so much. Working with eight individuals who were receiving care at the clinic, we provided each of them two disposable cameras. And I asked them to just document their response to a seemingly simple question. What does it mean to you to live with HIV and AIDS in your community? And through 24 clicks, each began to tell their own unique story, their hopes and dreams, their fears, their challenges, many, if not all, for the very first time. We pored over those photos. We talked about them, we discussed them, we reviewed them, and they served as powerful basis for group therapy sessions. But the photos took on an entirely new life when the group decided that they wanted to use them to tell a collective and external story through a 20-day public exhibit held in a cafe in the center of town. And this exhibit was game-changing, frankly, right? It told a new story, one that tackled a palpable stigma, and that challenged public opinion. And when I think back on this early experience, I learned so much, including just how powerful inclusive and representative storytelling can be in our line of work. And, you know, today, I think those lessons remain perhaps even more important than ever as we seek collectively to communicate for impact in the face of arguably some of the most daunting and pressing challenges our humanity has ever faced. I want to leave you and share, rather, I won't leave you, but I will share with you three of those lessons today. Number one, the story matters, but we need to put more focus on the storyteller. That means we need to reimagine how we are collecting and creating stories. We've talked a lot in recent years about representation, and I think that is so incredibly important, but I want to challenge us to move beyond representation to ownership. Folklore is not just a Taylor Swift album. It is a powerful form of intergenerational storytelling that withstands the test of time. Those who own a story must be allowed the opportunity and the space to tell it if they so wish, in their own voice and with their own direction. Number two, we have to engage in with communities as the experts that they are. We talk a lot about creating space at the table for communities, but I'm gonna disagree with that approach, if you'll bear with me. And I'm gonna question, what if we instead sought a seat at the communities table so that we might learn from them, learn with them, and nurture really meaningful, lasting relationships that can then inform responsive advocacy, policy, programming, and financing. And lastly, number three, we have to share our stories where they're going to be heard, regardless of whether we're trying to influence health behavior or policy action. Through compelling storytelling, we have an opportunity here to elevate voices, to lift communities, to represent lived experiences, and to promote new ways of working that can address human challenges, not challenged humans. But we have to tell those stories in spaces and in ways that will resonate with those who we're trying to reach. I think we can all agree that the world is rapidly changing around us. I mean, we are today at a different place than we were even mere months ago. People are more acutely aware of, engaged in public health and international security, perhaps than ever before. The world is listening, and I think what we say, how we say it as a global health and development community, really matters. You know, I think we're in a really interesting opportunity, a unique opportunity here, where we have a moment in time, and it really an imperative to use compelling storytelling, community-owned storytelling, to communicate for impact. And frankly, I think we have to do that because the question is no longer whether it's our responsibility to respond, but instead how we are responding responsibly. Thanks.